Voy a presentar a Sarah Jane Pell, artista australiana. Es artista experimental que explora tecnologías emergentes en entornos extremos y sus implicancias en el movimiento humano, en el movimiento corporal. Es profesora e investigadora asociada a la Universidad de Monash, Facultad de Ingeniería y Facultad de Arte, Diseño y Arquitectura. También es vicepresidenta del Comité Técnico de la Federación Internacional de Astronáutica para la Utilización Cultural del Espacio. Así que ahora Sara nos va a contar qué es lo que hace. Muchas gracias por estar y bienvenida.
Gracias. When I introduce myself, I would say that I'm an artist astronaut. And some people ask me, what business does an artist have in space? So let's talk about business for a second. The global annual economy for the space sector worldwide is approximately $314 to about $317 billion. Now, I'm an Australian, and when we think about space, much like here in Argentina, we think about Earth observation, satellite utilization, environmental monitoring, and telecommunications. They are our strongest assets in our region. Now, we are a new space player. We have only had a space agency for less than 18 months. But our country, we were the last of the developed world to have a space agency, but we have been actively involved in launch and space activities for over 50 years. Now, our local economy is less than 1% of the global space business economy. But we have new opportunities now that we foresee the possibility of working with our local assets, our strengths and technologies, including our research and development at the intersection of science, engineering, arts and technology. Now, what do artists have to do in space? Our local arts industries are the equivalent in Australia to 1/3 of the global space economy worldwide. So we have a significant place at the table to argue that our innovation capabilities within the arts can make a strong contribution to space exploration. Now, I'm a different kind of artist. I'm not necessarily interested in illustration or public relations, education and outreach. Artists can be involved in mutual discovery, in exploration, experimentation, prototype development and innovation. And I'm going to introduce the work that I do as I'm preparing to build this concept of the artist astronaut. In 2012, I argued that every space mission needs an artist for precisely these reasons. We need to be able to be resourceful as much as we develop the resources to enable space exploration. So I began my creative practice looking at human performance underwater. I became a commercial diver so that I could have a studio underwater. Fast forward 18 years, and I now work in space exploration, preparing for future lunar missions by working with spacesuits underwater. So let's look at how that journey has led to this point. I began to look at human performance underwater as a very personal journey into how humans perform and behave in other worldly environments. In this case, underwater, where the body rises and falls, where the body requires life support technology for breathing, where there are altered gravity conditions, neutral buoyancy that changes the way we perform and behave. I would also create artworks on land for an audience to share some small part of that experience. So the creative practice enables me to consider an entire world, a world-building principle. This is a term that is often used in cinematic arts, but it helps describe some of the experimental considerations and framing where I need to reconcile the advanced life support operation as well as the imaginative performance space, that future world that I must inhabit to create and perform and stay alive at the same time. Some of the projects that I've worked on, this is called Lifeboat, exemplified the signs of life. So I worked with biotechnology and artists from the Symbiotica lab in Western Australia, and we toured this work through the Baltic states, and we created a mobile biotechnology and art lab where we analysed the signs of life from the smallest petri dish to the broadest social systems, where every single participant or visitor became part of a meta life cycle. And we critiqued the broader exploration of these extreme environments. Now, my first NASA collaboration was working on a lunar habitat design to develop a closed loop life support system for the moon. Let's see if this plays. Yes. So the Lunar Gaia mission was ultimately about creating the first architectural pathway to enable the first crew to return to the moon to set up a base station, probably a fueling station for further exploration. Now, the Lunar Gaia model was particularly unique because it was an international, interdisciplinary and intercultural team of 30 people who worked on the design. They worked on the design at the International Space University and the NASA Ames Research Center, and by combining systems from various nations together, they were able to close the loop, the life support loop, to approximately 90%, which was almost double what had been achieved before. It also looked at how we could support the human to thrive and not just survive. We had to think about how people would live and work together. So my skills, having worked underwater, directly translated to this new world and to this new envisioning. It was the same technology, the same strategies and principles that are required to live underwater as we would need in space. There's just a few more complications about getting there, but it was the beginning of a journey. So some of the tests and models, including this dual rebreather, were tested and demonstrated, but the symbol of this was also flown with the Japanese Space Agency on their Sprite satellite as a symbolic gesture for how humans might prepare themselves for future missions. I also have worked with art and science collaboration to imagine how could I get to the moon one day. Now, following on from looking at radio astronomy, I have worked on various projects looking at how we can utilize the radio astronomy assets around the world for more poetic signs and signals. So rather than looking out into the universe, sending signals out, sending radio waves and transmitting them to the moon and back. So one of the projects was called Optics, and it used a moon bounce technology. So translating the visual component of an object into radio waves, sending it up to the moon, bouncing it back to Earth, and seeing the distorted transmission. So I can technically say that I've been on the moon. Well, maybe an image of myself. But that what didn't really satisfy things. As a performance artist, I need to feel the embodied experience and to imagine the embodied experience of what it would be like to live and work in a space like the moon. So I set up a series of projects to go from sea to summit to space. My first test was putting myself at high altitude in a Mount Everest expedition. And the idea was to take the knowledge that I had learned underwater about translating this beautiful performance in a strange aquatic world and learning to relay that to an audience. I wanted to develop tools that I could use at various altitudes so that I could send signs of life back to an audience at home. And if I could do that in this extreme environment, then I could demonstrate the principles to do that in a space context as well. This is what we call another space analog environment. It has features that are extreme, they are hostile. So I took all kinds of technology. This was 2015, and I took a very early version of a 360-degree camera with me, and all kinds of instruments attached to my body. And I tested them in the lab and then went out into the real world. But the real world is extreme and hostile. So three of my crew got altitude sickness before 5,000 meters. My expedition lead got dengue fever and had to fly home. And I continued on by myself with my Sherpa to Everest Base Camp. Now, this was 2015, and I was very fortunate to survive the Nepal earthquakes, and no one summited that year. So I had to think about what it meant. Do I go back? Do I stay? And I recognized that going to altitude was a stepping stone, but what I really wanted to achieve was getting to space. So I kept focus on that goal, and I developed a new project with the support of the Australia Council to explore performing astronautics. So I had performing aquanautics underwater, and now I wanted to look at performing astronautics in all of the contexts of the body in space, in ways that the engineers and the astronauts cannot yet describe. What language can a performance artist bring to connect us to that peculiar and unique experience? So I started all kinds of aerobatic training, testing my body, testing my perception, experiencing the G-forces, experiencing the disorientation, learning to fly instead of float. I began training as an astronaut candidate for a project called Project Possum. This is a polar suborbital science in the upper mesosphere mission. It's a mission that assists climate scientists. It is a short duration mission, or a series of short duration missions, where we use a special camera to document night shining clouds. Their technical name is noctilucent clouds. And they are polar clouds that are made of ice crystals. So actually, it's another body of water. From a glacier to an ocean to another body of water, these ice clouds in the upper mesosphere. And using this beautiful adapted camera to take long-range tomography or images of the cloud and a little antenna to take a sample of these ice crystals. As I go up to 108 kilometers and back down to Earth in less than 36 minutes. Another project is working as a simulation astronaut underwater. But I was the astronaut underwater, but this project compared the simulation astronaut in cooperation with a robot in the Rio Tinto desert of Spain and the underwater analog of Marseille in France.
We are comparing the analog
Can you hear this?
Site of Rio Tinto with the analog simulations in Marseille and also with lab testings. So we are trying to find out what do we get out of doing analog simulations and comparing robot and astronaut procedures.
The subsea landscape near Marseille was selected to represent the lunar surface. Here, scenarios were conducted in an even more complex way. The suit port, the rover, and all of the equipment had to be installed underwater before the astronaut could enter the suit.
All the moonwalk elements, such as the procedures, the tools, the suit port, but also the gesture-controlled rover, can be part of future space activities, space missions on the Moon and on Mars. And to advance Europe's capabilities, all these are important to prepare and train astronauts for these future missions.
In the future, we will be able to produce a new iteration of our human-machine interface, and we can come up with new concepts of operations that can make this work more effective. And of course, we would like that our hardware becomes flight ready and that once Europe or anybody wants to go to Mars or to the Moon, we will be able to have the hardware ready and useful for the tasks that are needed.
Project Moonwalk takes us one step further into the future of human space exploration, pairing humankind and technology to transcend known boundaries.
So Project Moonwalk was one of my favorite projects. I was able to work as a diver underwater. I could work in a spacesuit underwater. And I could work imaginatively as if I was on the moon. And my gestures controlled the robot. So it was very important that I learned how to perform and move. I also worked in a pool, testing the spacesuit before we began in the ocean, looking at the choreography of the body inside this particular suit, and showing them how I could trick the system. The biomedical engineers were reading my data on my body, and they predicted that I would fall over, but I didn't, and they couldn't understand why. The difference was when I exhale underwater, you leave a little pocket of air as the exhalation leaves a bubble that cavitates in the top of the helmet. So as I rise up and exhale, I have extra time before the weight of the suit comes down. So even though I might look like I'm about to fall, with that time, I can correct my body position before the weight of the suit lands. Now, yes, I can trick the system underwater, but this is not going to work on the moon. We need a different system. But in the ocean, it was a whole different story, because in the ocean, that's when I imagined being on the moon. So let's take a look at this artist-astronaut journey, really briefly. So through that, you get the sense that I want to be a part of this. I want to play. There's that operational side where I want it to be real. So I'm experimental, I'm an explorer, I'm creative, and I'm very curious. But how can the arts play a role in this? When we start to think about the intersections of arts, science, engineering, technology, and human expression, the poetics of what we're doing in exploration, we can start to design new systems for sharing, communicating, and experiencing these other worlds. And that's some of the work that I'm trying to develop. This is a playful title of a work that I tried called The Agency of Human Robotic Lunatics, where I tried to use a system in front of an audience that would help me translate the experience of the Project Moonwalk, so I could share the story more accurately. So I might turn the sound down on this one. Can we turn this up? Yeah. So I worked with a robot on stage called the Cinema Swarm. And this cinematic robot, designed by Cinema Swarm and Visitor Vision, tracked my movement on stage. And you can see I'm wearing motion trackers there, the Vive system. So I could talk through the experience of being in the pool, in the ocean, and imagining being on the moon, with an avatar on stage that replicated these environments. And I could describe the actions live for the audience, with intercut with it live footage from these environments. Still, I was getting to something, so I could have the human robotic underwater and the human robotic cooperation on stage. I was also looking at how to survive on the moon, and developing theatre plays to translate some of these lessons into funny, interactive audience participation activities. But this is not getting me closer to space, and this is not getting you closer to space either. So I started to work in space analog environments and mission scenarios. One of those was called Lunares at the Moon Mars station in Poland. I worked with an interdisciplinary, international, and intercultural crew. And we devised a whole series of projects so that the crew were researchers, research technicians, and also research subjects for transdisciplinary projects with collaborators all over the world. Everything from bioengineering to robotics to food systems to arts and communication systems were tested in this habitat. So we had a living quarter here, and underneath this bunker was a fully enclosed simulation crater, a dark crater, as if it was the far side of the moon. So we didn't see sunlight for 14 days. One of the projects was called Moonhenge. Do you know Stonehenge on Earth? Yes? We looked at the calculations for a lunar version of that, and we installed that in our beautiful dark crater. The team had to work over a series of EVAs, extra vehicular activity, or a spacewalk to make it happen. We also used a LIDAR in the dark to capture the environment, and we set up a loss of crew situation. Poor Omar, Vice Commander Omar, was lost in the crater somewhere. And there is our Mars rover. It was trying to track the lost astronaut. And there's the Moonhenge, as you can see. So this equipment could take an image, which was, I think, 47 billion pixel image of the environment. There I am in the Apollo suit there. And this is the Lucy Electric switch. So this data was uploaded from the mission to the Monash Immersive Visualization Platform. They could use their tools, a big cave, to walk through the space and help us identify where Commander Samara had been lost. Now, I asked a choreographer to go to the Monash Immersive Visualization Platform. He had never been in virtual reality. He had never been in a space environment before. And he entered the system and played and performed and interacted. He then sent that data back to me in Lunares. And I learned the dance that he choreographed from Earth in the Mars simulation. So this is really hard to describe. So we'll go through it with video, and you can start to see some of this process. It's like, how can we do a moon, Earth, moon choreographic transfer? Here's the beautiful cave. He's experiencing this for the first time. You'll recognize some of the aspects. This is what I've learned later on. So the dancer is now sending me the signals in virtual reality back on the moon with the instructions to follow his hands. It was a little bit nauseating. But we were able to create a translation, which was very strange for him at the end. At the end, when he saw my performance in the crater, he couldn't decipher himself from that image. which was lovely. So we had achieved a loop that we didn't expect to achieve. And we were able to present this work simultaneously to describe that transmission. So if we can do that with a choreographic performance, then we can do that with all types of signal training or human performance, embodied performance training scenarios. So another, I took this data set, the LIDAR data set, and again tried to work with an audience and the live avatar, this time using a motion capture suit to explore that landscape back for an audience. This. Oh. And the idea was to imagine that I was still on the moon. My avatar was
Madam
on the moon.
Madam Chairperson,
and
as
I
the
could
first order of business, it is with great sadness that I announce a loss of a crew of the original Lunar Federation. But it's too late to get back to nature. Nature is getting back to us. But here in space, we can't wait for your policies and processes to be agreed. Here, we must act. The first act of Parliament is therefore grievous sedition.
So there are a few technical problems with this work,
on Earth,
live and on stage.
In space.
But again, it was an experiment to test an idea and to translate something with an audience, a live audience. Another part of the creative development was using the motion capture suit to understand the body in altered gravity environments and to create a poetic translation for an audience. Using the cave system, so I used pre-recorded bodies where I went out and performed using motion capture. And I also used the live motion capture suit in before the audience in the cave. So one of these figures, I think this one, is me live in the space, interacting with the audience, and translating that to a body of light. So I'm going to finish this with this work. This is behind the scenes, but you'll get to see what it's really like. I'll leave it there. So I guess this work helps to translate something of the quality of the performance that I would like to achieve in space. So while in 2012 I would say that every space mission needs an artist, in 2019, I think that every artist needs a space mission. It's a really important change of position and a confidence in how we perceive and believe and imagine ourselves and our relationship to the future of exploration. So thank you.